What's up, YouTube? It is the end of the month, so that means it is time for yet another pickup video. Tonight I'll be walking you through the games I picked up in the month of June 2014. This is a big pickup video this month, so hopefully you are ready for this. I've got everything kind of organized by system, but there are a lot of systems to cover, so let's just get going here. We'll start off with some key pieces of my NES collection that I got this month. This is really exciting because I've been kind of stuck on NES collecting for quite a while with the last few games I need. I am super close to having everything made for the system, and I obviously know the one roadblock is probably going to be getting a copy of Stadium Events. But let's look at what I picked up this month. So I got the last Color Dreams game I needed to complete the Color Dreams set, and that is Secret Scout in the Temple of Demise. Sure, this is a horrible game, but pretty cool to get this. I've been looking for this one forever. Had to finally just resort to getting one as a buy it now on eBay, but I got a decent price on it, so I'm pretty happy about that. Next is one my friend Charlie helped me out with, and that is the last licensed game for the system that I need outside of Stadium Events. And I don't know why this one took me so long to get. I mean, all the really, really hard games to get I've had for years, but that is Godzilla 2. And this is just one, for some reason, I could never find it in the wild, but my friend Charlie helped me out. He picked one up on eBay for me, and we did a swap for it. So that is the last licensed game for NES I needed outside of Stadium Events. So that is super cool. Next, I started collecting just a couple of the label variants for the system. I'm not going to be the type of person that goes after like all the five-screw variants and Color Dreams casing variants and all that kind of stuff, but there's a few I did want to pick up that I guess I've kind of skipped over the years. So this is one I didn't even really know about until recently, and that is Wayne Gretzky Hockey. This is the variation of it. One thing you notice is Wayne Gretzky is wearing a different uniform on this one than he is on the first version of this cartridge, and the LA Kings logo has been airbrushed out on this one. So I guess they lost the team license for this game. The other way you can tell that this is the later version of the game is this has the late release NES warning label on the back that has the additional information about cleaning your games. So this is obviously the version that came out after the original version. But pretty cool. Just, you know, whatever. That was kind of a neat label variation because it's a totally different picture of Wayne Gretzky on this version. Next we have one that I've had the box for many years, but I just never had the cartridge of this variant. And this is the only version of this that came out in this series, but that is the Konami Classic Series version of Blades of Steel. I don't know why they re-released this game with this red border and this Konami Classic Series. They probably intended to re-release some of the other Konami games in this fashion, but that never happened. So I don't think this is super rare, but I think it's kind of a cool curiosity to have. So just the label variant of Blades of Steel. Next, I just stumbled on a complete copy of one of my favorite games on the system that I didn't have complete. I just had a cartridge and manual for it before. I got this super cheap, so I just decided to pick it up and upgrade the copy I had. So I got a really nice complete copy of Ninja Gaiden 2 this month, which is a great, great game on the system. So one of my favorites. Let's go to the next system, and that is Nintendo GameCube. So I just picked up a few games for this system this month. We'll start off with Space Raiders. And this is a great kind of update to Space Invaders by Taito. I've owned the import PS2 version of this for many years. This is a great arcade-style game. This is the only US version of it it came out as, is GameCube, but I highly recommend picking this up. You can get this game very cheap. Next is Mario Kart Double Dash. And I had Super Mario Kart on Super Nintendo as soon as it came out. Played the absolute crap out of it, but really never bought any of the other Mario Kart games, which I'm not sure why. So I want to play this. I'm curious how this turns out. I know everyone else is playing Mario Kart 8 right now, but here I am just kind of catching up and getting the GameCube game. Next is another game that I've had in import form for several years. I've had the Dreamcast import version of this pretty much since it came out as well. But I wanted to get the only U.S. release of this as well, and that is Ikaruga for GameCube. So this is the classic shooter by Treasure, and it's a pretty good game. I'm not as fanboyish about this game as some people are. I think if you play a lot of 2D shooters, you'll realize that this isn't really one of the best ones, but it's got some cool graphical tricks, and I mean, it's neat that it came out in the U.S., so I think it's a cool game to add to the collection. Finally, for GameCube, I picked up another game that's kind of a 2D style game. I haven't even played this one yet. I don't know. It might not really be my taste, but I think it's kind of neat to have. The GameCube version of it is probably the rarest one. I think it came out on Xbox and PS2 also, and that is Alien Hominid. So it's kind of a Metal Slug-ish 2D shoot-em-up type side-scroller. So, I don't know. I'll give it a shot, see how it is. Next system, and this will be a quick one because I just bought one game for it this month, is the original Xbox, and that is the arcade port of King of Fighters 2002 and King of Fighters 2003. This is one of those SNK Playmore re-releases that came out after Playmore kind of took over the reins at SNK. I don't think this one sold super well, so it's kind of neat to have. I probably won't play this too much. Next system we'll go over is the Sega Saturn, and I picked up a few complete games for that this month. First one of these is Frank Thomas Big Hurt Baseball. I had this game on Super Nintendo when I was a kid, and it's really not that good. Hopefully the Saturn version's a little better, but I wanted this because Frank Thomas is one of my favorite all-time baseball players. I thought he was just awesome in the 90s, and this version was so nice and complete that it even had the foam, and better than that, it had the original Donruss baseball card that the game came with. So I think that's kind of neat. I think if you want to own this game complete, you need to have all these little pieces. So very, very well-preserved copy of this game. The next one I got is also Frank Thomas, and that is All-Star Baseball 1997 featuring Frank Thomas. Haven't played this one yet. I don't know. It's probably one of the rarer sports games on the system, I think. I think this one's... You don't see it pop up too much on eBay, so I'd say this one's pretty rare. I don't really expect too much from this, but whatever. I'll give it a shot. This one didn't come with a baseball card, though. Not so cool. They should have done that. Next is Decathlete, and this is one of the first-party Sega games for the Saturn. I don't know. I've heard good things about this. I remember EGM rated this, like, all nines or something like that back in the day. They really loved this game, so I want to play this. I think it's cool to have this. The next one is another Sega first-party sports game, and that is Winter Heat. And you don't see this one very much. This was one of the later releases that they put out. I think this came out the exact same time as Steep Slope Sliders, which I haven't picked up yet, but I do want to get that one. So this is kind of neat to have. I don't know. I'd like to play this one, see how it is. And finally for Saturn, this is one that I've been looking for a long time. I remember this game you didn't see very often in stores even when it came out. But that is High Velocity by Atlus. And I believe this in Japan is like the Chuge Drift Challenge series. It's like a mountain drift racing game or something like that. So, I don't know. I remember that series was really big in Japan, but this is the only one that came out in the U.S. as far as I know. So, in U.S. it's High Velocity by Atlus. Kind of cool. Next system is the Sega CD, and this will be real quick because I just got one game for it. This is a game, for some reason, I thought I owned this. I keep seeing this in game stores. It's not a rare game by any means. But every time I'd see it, I'd just be like, oh, I own that. I don't need to pick that up. But it turns out I didn't, so I picked it up finally. I got a really nice complete copy of this, and that is Rise of the Dragon. I think it's just another like kind of cyberpunk video mystery type game. But you got to remember, on Sega CD, you have Snatcher, which is like the best game of that type on any system, probably, in my opinion, because I love Snatcher. So I don't really know why you would play this when you can play Snatcher, unless you just are budget-minded, because this game goes for about $15, and Snatcher is several hundred now. So, moral of the story, get Snatcher first if you can. If you can't, play this, because it's probably pretty cool, too. So, cool. Rise of the Dragon. Next system is Atari 2600, and I don't know, I'm kind of, like, tapped out on 2600. I don't really feel the need to collect very actively for that system. I have a lot of the games I want to play on it, but I'm not really obsessive about it. I'm never going to go for a full 2600 collection. However, if I find like cheap complete games that are some of the oddball like smaller developers on the system, I like picking those up. So actually, I got both of these cheap this month, and these are both complete. The first one of those is Shark Attack, and this is one of the games by Apollo. They kind of have a neat cartridge design too. It's a little bit out of the norm. But it's very colorful label. It has a nice edge label on it and everything like that. So I thought that was kind of cool. And the next one is another one by Apollo. And got it at the same place, same time. And that is a complete copy of Lost Luggage. I think both of these games kind of came out during the video game crash. So I would say they're probably some of the rarer games on the system. But yeah, kind of neat to get these complete. Kind of an unusual find. I was surprised to get those. So I'll take anything like that when I can find it for $2,600. Next system is the Wii. And this is a game that is really cool. I've played it extensively. I just never bought my own copy of it. I don't know, really know why. I was just kind of waiting for a good price on it, but I got one cheap this month, so happy to add this to the collection, because guess what? It's 2D ninja action, and that's one of my favorite genres. But that is Muramasa, the Demon Blade. And this is a very cool, great graphics, you know, 2D style game that's kind of out of time for when it came out. I mean, there weren't a lot of games like this on the market. So if you have played all the classic ninja action games, get this one, because this lives up to all the classics. The next one I got for Wii, I haven't played this one yet, but I was a big fan of its prequel. And this one is Sin and Punishment Star Successor. So, yeah, Sin and Punishment was a Japanese-only game on the N64, and I am not an N64 fan at all. I've got a very small collection for that system, but that is one of the games I will stand up for. That was an exclusive for that system, and it's a great game. I think it's cool that this came out on the Wii in the U.S., so, yeah, I'll give this a play for sure, because I want to see how this is. So, Sin and Punishment for the Wii. Next system we'll go over is the PS2, and I got a pretty decent stack of PS2 games this month. I think if you remember the last month's video, I was working on the Dot Hack series of games, and there is 4 in the regular Dot Hack series of games. I picked up 1, 2, and 4 last month, so the one I needed was Part 3. Well, this month I got Part 3, so guess what? That's complete. However, once you have the Dot Hack series 1 through 4, there's also the Dot Hack GU series, and there's 3 games in that series. So I started on that now, too, because I'm trying to hunt those down cheaply, because these games are really starting to go for some big bucks on eBay. But I got well-priced copies of these this month, and I got Dot Hack GU Volume 1, which is Rebirth. And then I didn't get Part 2 yet, but I did get Volume 3, so I got Dot Hack GU Volume 3 Redemption. But I'll be trying to get Part 2 next month so I can have all the Dot Hack games, which would be 7 of them. So kind of cool to get those, because there's a very expensive series these days to pick these up. So, yeah, Dot Hack. Next one is Bloody Roar 4, and this is probably the rarest Bloody Roar game in the series from 1 to 4. I haven't played it yet, but I do like this series, and I think it's kind of neat that Hudson developed these as a fighting game, because it's not really what they were normally known for, but these are actually pretty fun games usually. So, got a really nice complete copy of that. The next one is one I've never even seen this game before. I didn't know anything about it. I picked up the case. It said it was an action RPG. It's by Koei, of all people, who usually makes all those strategy games that I'm not into at all. But this one is Colosseum Road to Freedom. And I got it cheap. It looks like it goes for somewhat decent money on eBay. And so, I don't know, kind of neat to have, because I don't think they made very many of this one. Next is just a common game I got cheap, is Ark the Lad, Twilight of the Spirits. So after the Ark the Lad collection on PS1, then some of those games in that series started coming over to the US pretty regularly. So there's a few more Ark the Lad games out there now. But this, I think this was the first one after the collection came out on PS1 that we got. I talked about the SNK Playmore fighting games on that game I got on Xbox earlier. But I picked up some more in that series of arcade re-releases that they put out. And first of those is Fatal Fury Battle Archives, Volume 2. And then I got Neo Geo Battle Coliseum, which I think is kind of like their Capcom vs. SNK, something kind of like that. It's got all their characters in it. It's got even the people from Metal Slug in it. So I think that's kind of cool. Next one is Art of Fighting Anthology. And that has 3 Art of Fighting series games on it. I don't know, there's just a couple more of these too, so I might as well just go ahead and get them all, because they're cheap. Next is a Atlus game that isn't very expensive, unlike most of their games, but I think it's kind of unique that they put this out, and that is Hard Hitter Tennis for PS2. It actually looks pretty decent from the pictures on the box. I haven't played it yet. I mean, I really like the Virtua Tennis games on Dreamcast, so it might be decent. I'll give it a shot, see how it is. Next one I got is Suikoden Tactics, and the one thing I noticed about this, I thought it was complete when I got it, but it has a note on the back that it says it has a bonus limited edition soundtrack music CD. I don't know, there's no extra tray in here, so maybe I'm missing the second tray, but I don't have the bonus CD, so I might try to upgrade this one later and get a more complete copy if there is such a thing. The next one I picked up is Shinobi, and this was kind of the return of this classic series. It had been gone for several years after the Saturn game, the Saturn FMV-related game, I guess. But this is pretty decent. I remember playing this one when it came out. There also was the sequel to it, which was Kunoichi in Japan, or Nightshade in the U.S., and it had a female ninja instead of a shinobi. So it was a good game, too. Kind of used the same game engine. But, yeah, I think this was a worthy return to the series that you could pick this game up cheap. It's pretty fun. Next one was another one I really wasn't very familiar with. I just picked it up because, I don't know, it was cheap and it looked like it was going to be pretty decent. And that is Soul Nomad and the World Eaters. Okay. But strategy RPG, it looks like. Decent graphics from the box, so, I don't know, might be kind of fun. Next one is one of those games that, like, is just everyone considers an essential game on the PS2, and it's just one of those games, I don't know, I've just never picked up before, so I'll play it. Haven't yet, but that is Ico. And then, obviously, I need the sequel, or semi-sequel, Shadow of the Colossus, too, which I don't own yet either, but I don't know. I go for kind of the more obscure games, and I hear about these blockbuster games like this, and I usually pass on them unless it's something I just really, really want to play. But, I don't know, when I get them cheap like this, it's worth having in the collection, so I'll give it a shot, see how it is, see if it's worth the hype. Finally, for PS2, I have Coldcept, and this is a card-battling game. The reason I wanted this game, it's kind of obscure. This is a big series in Japan, and I think this is the only one we ever got in the U.S., but I think it's kind of unique because it's published by NEC, which was a return from their TurboGrafx days back when they were publishing big in the U.S. But the only two games they put out when they came back was this and Tube Slider on the GameCube, which I picked up a few months ago. Both of those games flopped miserably in the U.S. and then they went away again. So NEC, the electronics company, is still obviously going strong, but their gaming division is once again dead. So I don't know, maybe someday NEC will come back. But I think it was cool that they made a short return to the U.S. for their gaming division. Next system is the Super Nintendo, and I picked up a few complete games and quite a few loose ones this month, so we'll start with the loose ones, I guess. First one I have is Wiz by Tidus. This is one of the late release Tidus games for the system, of which there's many. Haven't played it yet. I don't know. I don't really expect much. It's Tidus. Next one is one I had as a kid, and I don't know. Ninja Turtles were like big in my life for a while, and then there was like a moment where that was like the least cool thing possible, so I just dumped all my Ninja Turtles stuff. But that is Turtles 4, Turtles in Time, and I'm sure this game is as good as everyone thinks it is now. I mean, I played the crap out of this as a kid, but I just sold everything I had that was Turtles because it just wasn't cool to own anymore. So I don't know, it's cool to have this again because I'm sure I'll give it another shot. I do remember this game was pretty good version of the arcade game, so cool to have that. The next one is Arcana by HAL Labs, which I think is like kind of an early card battling game or something of that sort. Haven't played it yet. The next one is Cybernator, which is a cool like mech 2D shooting game. There was a couple other games in this series. I believe it spawned the Assault Suits Lanos series. So I think it's kind of neat that we got this one in the U.S. because there were some others that were Japan exclusives. Next one, I was really excited to find this game, but this is a pretty darn rare copy of the Joe and Mac series, and that is Joe and Mac 2, Lost in the Tropics. This has some really cool artwork on it. I like the box of this, too. It has a big old sticker on it that EGM rated this game gold when it came out, so it should be pretty darn good. I haven't played it yet, but I do like the Joe and Mac series in general, and I think this was probably the pinnacle of the series. Pretty darn tough game to find on the Super Nintendo. I've been looking for this for a while. Next is nothing nearly as exciting, but that is Super Goal 2 by Jalico. And I'm not a Star Wars fan at all, so we'll just skip through this one real quick. But that is Super Star Wars. That's all I'm going to say about that. Next is Spider-Man and the X-Men Arcade's Revenge. Used to own this game on the Genesis, and it's really lousy, unless it's better on Super Nintendo. But unfortunately, it's one of those LJN games that, they don't make good games. Next is a port of Raiden Trad, and I don't think the Super Nintendo version is known to be one of the better ports of this game, but it came out on it at least, so I have to own it, unfortunately. I have Raiden on many other systems. The PS1 version of the arcade game is probably the best to own. Next is a game that my friend Bob helped me out with on a trade this month, and this is one of the big expensive titles on the system, and that is Castlevania Dracula X. It is kind of related to the PC Engine-only Dracula X game, which I do own, and that's one of the reasons I never bought this game, because it's a lesser port of that game. So the PC Engine version is the one to own, unless you just must own a Super Nintendo only, but this is a great game. If you do like Castlevania games, I recommend picking this up. Next, let's go through the more complete games I got. First one of those is missing the box, but I did get a cartridge and manual for Illusion of Gaia. And I don't know, I might try that one out, I guess. It's probably one of the more common RPGs on the system. Next is a complete copy of The Adventures of Mighty Max. This is a super, super nice copy of this game. I don't think this was ever played. I mean, the manual, everything is incredibly crisp. So I love finding games like this cheap in this condition. I mean, you don't see much of this. I kept my games in condition like this even when I bought them as a kid, but there's not a lot of other people that did, especially back then. So cool to get a nice copy of this game, even if it is just kind of a common one. Finally, for Super Nintendo, I have Indiana Jones' Greatest Adventures. And this kind of covers all three of the Indiana Jones first three movies in the trilogy. And I don't know, it looks really cool from the box. It's a LucasArts game. Obviously, I don't really like George Lucas type stuff, but I do like the Indiana Jones movies, so I'll give this a shot. I'm kind of curious how this is. Alright, so the next game I got is a re-release of the TurboGrafx classic Military Madness, and that is Nectaris Military Madness. So they did a kind of a mild remake of this game, but it's pretty faithful to the original, which is a cool pickup. I've been looking for this game for a while, so this is a neat find this month. Jalico put it out in the US, which is kind of unique because, yeah, they had nothing to do with the original one. The next game is kind of a remake of Ridge Racer for the PS1. I did always like the Ridge Racer games, but this was one that, I don't know, it's kind of like Ridge Racer 1.5. There's really not a whole lot of reason to buy this if you already have Ridge Racer and some of the other games in the series. But that is Ridge Racer Revolution, so just kind of a fresh coat of paint for the original Ridge Racer game. Next is a game that I thought I had, but it turns out I didn't, and that is a game that I played a lot when it came out, and I think is a great game, and that is Kajero Deception 2 by Tecmo, which is a really cool game, so excited to get that in the collection. The next one is another obscure Tecmo game, and you might laugh at this, but this is actually a game I've really been wanting. It's a fun game, despite the stupid license, but that is Monster Rancher Hopabout, and yeah, I don't know, this is pretty darn tough to find, but it's a fun game. Next is a Art Dink developed game, and it's quirky like most stuff I like, but it's really not that great a game, so I don't know, I got it cheap, whatever. And that is No One Can Stop Mr. Domino. Yeah. I don't know, it's okay, whatever. Next one is the first in the big series of Tales series games that came to the U.S. The series was alive in Japan long before that. There were games on Super Famicom. But now there's really no systems left that don't have a Tales series game on it. So this was the first one we got in the U.S., and that is Tales of Destiny. So it's nice to get a very good condition, complete copy of this one. Next is a game that I was looking for a long time. This is one of the harder to find games in the Runabout series that came out in the U.S., but that is Runabout 2. And this one's relevant because Hot B published it here, and so this game was a big flop. There was minimal distribution for this game. I think this is going to be one of the harder ones for people to get whenever they're trying to finish off a PS1 collection someday. So, but yeah, Runabout 2, it's kind of cool to get this. The version that came out before this in the U.S. was called Felony 1179, if you're looking for that one too. Next is a RPG, a 3-disc RPG that is probably one of the mid-tier ones on the system. I don't think this one's essential by any means, but that is Galarians, and I don't have a lot to say about that one. Next is a rally racing game that I've owned several of the rally games on PS1. I just never owned this one. I think this one's supposed to be pretty decent, so I do want to try this, and that is Colin McRae Rally. I don't know, I think there's a lot of Colin McRae games that came after this one, but this one I haven't played before, so hopefully it's pretty decent. I talked about the Deception series earlier, and I do really love that series. I did actually already own this game, but I got a cheap copy of this month that I'm just going to use as trade bait or I'll resell, and that is Deception 3 Dark Delusion. This is a great game, and actually, guess what? I got two extra copies of it this month. So if you're needing this game, let me know quickly, because it's certainly up on the block for trade or sell. So great game, can't recommend this highly enough. So that is all I have for PS1 this month. Let's move on to the Sega Genesis. So first I picked up a game that was not on my radar at all. I thought I owned all the shooters for the system already, but this is one that I had no idea it was a shooter. I always thought this was like a flight sim or something like that. This is actually a great game, and this is Battle Squadron for the Sega Genesis. I think this is a European-developed shooter. It might have had some ports on like European computers or some of the systems over there, but I can't recommend this highly enough. It's super difficult. It's got really good graphics for its time. This should be an essential shooter if you like collecting shooters. I'd like to get a complete copy of this now that I know what it is, but this is really cool and a big surprise for me. Next up, I have a complete copy of Virtua Fighter 2, and this is one of the paper box games that came out late in the system life. Sure, it was pushing the Genesis pretty hard to have a port of Virtua Fighter 2 on it, but you can get better versions of this game on other systems. But I think it's kind of cool that it came out on the Genesis, even in a lesser format. So, yeah, Virtua Fighter 2. And next is a game that I already owned, but I upgraded to a complete copy this month. It's one of my favorite arcade ports on the Genesis, along with its sequel, and that is Rolling Thunder 2. And you can also find Rolling Thunder 3 on the Genesis. These are really cool, kind of obscure Namco ports of the arcade game that came out after the original Rolling Thunder that more people have played. So this one has some cool graphics, and I can't recommend this highly enough if you have a Sega Genesis. Next is another game I upgraded, a cart-only copy I had. I got a really nice mint condition copy of this from my friend Charlie, but that is Saint Sword by Taito. And I think this is an underrated game as well. This is really fun to play. Like I said, this one is exceptional. I mean, it's got the original poster ad for the Taito games of the time, which is cool. Manual and cartridge are in excellent shape as well. So, yeah, need to get that in complete form. I've already sold my loose copy, so that was easy to get rid of, and now I have an upgrade to a complete one, so that's cool. Finally, was another upgrade for the Genesis, and this is another classic shooter on the system I think everyone should own. It's a port of the arcade game by Toho Plan, and that is Truxton. So, just again, a game I've owned for years, but I did an upgrade this year to a complete copy. So, some nice upgrades for Genesis this month. The next system I'll go over is the Sega Game Gear. So I got a few games for that this month. First is a shooter, Aerial Assault. It's a horizontal shooter. It's nothing too special, but kind of neat to get it. It was very cheap. Next is RC Grand Prix. And I've played the Master System version of this game. It's okay. It's not very great, but I think it's kind of neat that it came out for Game Gear as well. It's a top-down RC racing game. Next is Dragon Crystal, which is probably one of the more obscure games on the system. And even more obscure than that is Crystal Warriors. This is one of the more expensive games on the system, which I got really cheap, so I think that's kind of cool to pick up. Next is another obscure game on the system that doesn't go for a lot of money, but that is Putt and Putter Miniature Golf. And I don't know, I don't like golf, but I like mini golf, so this might be okay. I'd like to try it out. Next is a Sonic game that came out for the system. They were kind of capitalizing on the Mario Kart popularity, so they came out with Sonic Drift 2, and this was a Game Gear exclusive. It's kind of neat to have. That's all I picked up for Game Gear this month. Let's do some more portables. So the next one I have is the Nintendo DS. This is a game that I've been looking for really hard over the last few months. For some reason, I just can't find this in a store. I'm sure I can buy one on eBay, but that's no fun. But that is a game that I've been wanting to play because I found out the artwork was done by the same person that did the game Tail Concerto on PS1, which is a great, great game for PS1 if you don't have that. But this one is called Sola 2 Robo. Kind of a weird title. So I've got a reprinted copy of the case here. Unfortunately, it is cartridge only, but until I can upgrade, I just want to play this game. I mean, I'm excited about getting this, and I think this is going to be a fun game to play. So, Sola 2 Robo for DS. The next one is a DS game I've been looking for that I've been just, another one that's kind of unique that I've been wanting to play, and that is Lunar Knights. And I think this is a game that probably most people don't realize is a Hideo Kojima game. So if you're a big fan of Metal Gear or Snatcher or some of the other games he did, this is another game he did that kind of fell under the radar. I think it's a semi-sequel to the Game Boy Color game Boktai, or Game Boy Advance. I can't remember which system that came out for. I think it was Game Boy Advance. But yeah, that's another one that was kind of a unique Hideo Kojima game that most people don't realize is by him. So Lunar Knights for DS, I think that's a cool one to pick up. I got that complete. Next system I'll do is Game Boy Advance, and I picked up two complete games for this system this month. First one of these, I didn't realize I already owned. I think I bought it back when it came out, and I just kind of forgot about it. Is one of my favorite series of all time is Bubble Bobble, and I picked up Bubble Bobble Old and New. So it has a port of the original Bubble Bobble arcade game, which is cool. It also has a new, like, graphically enhanced version of Bubble Bobble with new levels that unfortunately is not very good at all. I don't think Taito actually developed it themselves. I think they farmed it out to somebody. So that kind of explains why it's not that great. So I actually already own this game, so I'll just sell this one. It's not a big deal. This game goes for some decent money. But yeah, Bubble Bobble Old and New. Next is another complete game for Game Boy Advance, and another one of my favorite series. I actually own the arcade game of this, but that is Mr. Driller 2. And I don't know how faithful it is to the arcade game yet. I haven't tried it. I think this is actually the only port of this that came home. It's just the Game Boy Advance game, because they did Mr. Driller G on Japanese PlayStation, and then there was Mr. Driller Drill Land on Japanese GameCube. So there's a lot of import-only ports of the ports and new games in the series that came out after this. But if you're looking for Mr. Driller 2, which was kind of the first when it branched off into additional characters, this is the one to get. And this is the first appearance of Mr. Driller's father, Dig Dug, which is kind of cool in the series. So, yeah, if you like Mr. Driller games, pick this one up. I got a nice complete copy of this month. Next, we'll do original Game Boy, and I picked up a bunch of games for the Game Boy this month. As I said before, I am trying to collect all the black and white Game Boy games. I know that's a big undertaking, and I'm kind of taking my time at doing it. But it's fun collecting that. There's a lot of obscure games on the system. One thing I don't see very often is complete Game Boy games for the black and white system, so I try to pick those up when I can. It's not necessarily a priority, but it's always nice to have these complete. So the first one I got is Ken Griffey Jr. Baseball, and I don't know how the Game Boy version of this game is. I used to have it on Super Nintendo as a kid, and I played tons of it. I said before I loved Frank Thomas as a kid. Ken Griffey Jr. was probably my second favorite player as a kid, so it was a neat license that Nintendo used for their baseball game, so I think that's cool. The next one I got complete on Game Boy is in even better condition. I'm really surprised. This one's like brand new. They probably never even played it. But that is Ishido, Way of the Stones. And just a puzzle game. I don't really think this one's anything special, but and it's not rare by any means. But in this condition, wow. Like, that's somebody that took care of their games. I'm impressed by this. Next, I have a whole bunch of loose Game Boy games. Some of these I actually picked up last month, but I forgot to show them in the last video, so I'm just getting caught up here with what all I have. First off, I picked up one of the more obscure games on the system. I don't think a lot of people realize how rare this game is, but that is Power Mission. And what's funny is I actually picked up two copies of Power Mission this month. So I found the one, I was super excited to get it, and then a few days later I found another one, and I figured, well, you know what, that was a hard game for me to find, I'm going to pick it up so I can help somebody else out. So if you need this game for your Game Boy collection, please let me know. Next I have Track Meet, nothing special here. The next one is Titus the Fox, so believe it or not, crappy developer Titus actually made a game starring their own mascot. Bet everyone wanted to play that one. Next is Ultima Runes of Virtue 2. So there are two of these on Game Boy. This is the harder one to find. Next is a game that everyone seems to really love. These are gaining in popularity super quick now. I'm not a big fan of this series. I love this style of game. I just don't think these are executed that well. So maybe the Game Boy version will surprise me, but I'm not a big fan of the NES version of this game. However, it is one of the super rare games on the Game Boy, just like the NES version is very rare too. And that is Snow Brothers. So there's probably several fans of this game out there. I'm just not really one of them. I think this game is somewhat sloppy compared to other games of this genre. Next is one of the other rarer games on the system, and that is Mega Man 4. It's actually the first one in the Mega Man series I own on Game Gear, or Game Boy, so I have some catching up to do. I need to get 1 through 3 and also 5 now. Next I have Ninja Boy. I think I picked up Ninja Boy 2 a couple months ago, so now I have the first one. Next I have, I think this is a unique game in this series. I haven't played this one yet, but this one should be pretty cool. It's Battletoads in Ragnarok's World. So if this is a unique game in the series from the original Nintendo game, I'm sure it's pretty good and devilishly hard, just like the original one is. I mentioned mini golf games before. Here's another one. So this is kind of an unusual use of a license. But that is The Simpsons Itchy and Scratchy in Miniature Golf Madness. So if you've ever wanted to see Itchy and Scratchy fight on the golf course, I guess this is the game you would want to get. It's an interesting use of the license, like I said. Next, I have a game. This is a European game. And one of the rarest games on the U.S. Game Boy is a game called Cool Ball, which I don't have yet. I need to get that one. But this is actually the European version of the game. I really have no idea if this is rare in Europe or not. I just happened to pick this up super cheap. I don't even know how this game ended up in the U.S. But that is the Euro version of Cool Ball, which is called Pop Up. Just a simple puzzle game, so I don't really think it's anything that special. Next, I have Yogi Bear's Gold Rush. Haven't played that yet. Next is a game that I think is excellent on the NES. I haven't played the Game Boy version of it yet, but that is Felix the Cat by Hudson Soft. Another one of the Game Boy games that's kind of difficult to get, and it's probably a pretty good game if it's like the NES game, so I do want to play this one. Next I have Dick Tracy by Bandai. And then we have Race Days by Game Tech. Since it's two games in one, I don't know, I guess it's like a stock car racing and Jeep racing or something like that. Whatever. Next is one of the Contra series games, and that is Operation C. And then we have Chase HQ, one of the millions of Chase HQ games that came out on systems over the years. Next we have a port of the cool game Micro Machines, and this is excellent on many systems. Hopefully the Game Boy version holds up, because that's definitely a highlight when you have one of these early Micro Machines games to play on a system. Next is a Jaleco game called The Fidgets. I don't know if this is a licensed cartoon or what. I've never actually heard of it before. Maybe it's just unique to the game, but it kind of, to me, it looks like something that was maybe a known cartoon. I'm not sure. If you know, please comment. Let me know what's up with The Fidgets. Next is a wrestling game that I think is one of the rarer ones, and that is WCW, The Main Event. I saw this label in a store, and I just said, I'm not even familiar with that one. I don't see that very often at all, so that's why I wanted to pick that up. Next is Spy vs. Spy, which has a very bright label on that one. The next one is a port of the original early arcade game, and that is Mr. Do. And then we have a mini version of the PlayStation-era fighting game, Battle Arena Toshiden. And then we have another Jaleco game. I haven't played this one yet. It kind of looks like a Contra clone. Hopefully it is. I like that style of game. But that is Fortified Zone. So maybe that one's decent. Next we have Penguin Wars. And then another port of a TurboGrafx or Hudson Soft game. And that is Bonk's Adventure. And again, this came out pretty good on the NES, so hopefully it holds up on the Game Boy as well. I do like the Bonk series games quite a bit, so that should be kind of neat to play. Next is another Titus game, and this came out on Super Nintendo as well. That is Prehistoric Man. It's decent on Super Nintendo. Maybe play that one a little bit. Next we have a few puzzle games, and first of those is Wordtris. Next one, sorry, I have a case to pop open here, is Hattris, which is not very good. I've played Hattris on NES quite a bit, and I don't like it. The next one is another Tetris series game, and that is Tetris Plus. And finally, for original Game Boy, I have, this is kind of relevant right now with the World Cup going on, I have World Cup 98, which is pretty late release for black and white Game Boy, so it's kind of cool that that came out. Finally, to wrap up the portables, I have just a couple games for the Game Boy Color. And the first one of these is one of the Blaster Master series games. It's kind of cool to have. It is Blaster Master Enemy Below. And next I have Yogi Bear Ultimate Balloon Race. The reason I wanted this one, it's actually a port of the arcade Taito game Poppin' Pop. And that is a very cool arcade game that for some reason they stuck Yogi characters in for the US and then licensed it for the Game Boy Color. So despite the dated license that nobody really cares about, I'm sure it's actually a pretty good game because Poppin' Pop is a fun arcade game. All right, so we've covered a lot of systems so far. If you are not a Dreamcast fan, you might as well tune out now because the rest of the video is all Dreamcast. If you love the Dreamcast, you're in for a treat. I have been aggressively collecting Dreamcasts this month. I have decided I want to have all the games on the Dreamcast, and that is my most immediate collecting goal right now. So that's what I'm really focusing my energy on this month and beyond. I picked up over 60 games for the Dreamcast this month, so it's a mix of licensed crap and PC ports, as well as some of the more exciting titles on the system. The nice thing about Dreamcast is some of the rarest games on the system I've owned since they came out. So it makes it somewhat easy to collect for the system because I don't need to shell out money for a lot of like the $100 games. I already have them. So I'm going to cover a lot of games for the Dreamcast. I'll try to kind of blow through these. If you're not a Dreamcast fan, might as well tune out now because that's the rest of the video. So get ready for this. We'll cover these as fast as I can. So first up, I have a copy of the arcade classic, and this was known in Japan as Dynamite Deca 2, but in the US it is Dynamite Cop, and it's also kind of known as the Die Hard arcade game on Saturn. This is the sequel to that. So the Dreamcast version didn't have Bruce Willis in it, but still just as good of a manic arcade style game. Good stuff, Dynamite Cop. Next I have POD Speed Zone. Nothing special there. Then I have Tokyo Extreme Racer. I love this series. It's just, I already had Tokyo Extreme Racer 2 when it came out, and I really saw no reason to get the earlier one. But now that I'm collecting Dreamcast, I have to own this. So still a cool game if you haven't played it. Good series, good game in that series. Now we get into some stuff I just don't care about, but I need anyway. Air Force Delta. Aero Wings. Spirit of Speed 1937. Unfortunately, this is where this guy came back. LJN. They actually thought they were going to bring it back. Acclaim thought that we needed more LJN games. No, we do not need more LJN games. Let that die a miserable death. LJN did enough harm in its glory days. Next we have the arcade game Silent Scope. Then we have some garbage. We have Frogger 2 Swampy's Revenge. Nothing exciting here. We have one of the three Sega arcade fishing games for the system, which is Sega Marine Fishing. There's also Sega Bass Fishing 1 and 2 for the Dreamcast. Another PC port, I believe. This is nothing special at all. Coaster Works. Then we get into more stuff I don't care about. Spec Ops 2 Omega Squad. Then we have Suzuki Alster Extreme Racing, because things had to be extreme around the year 2000. Remember that. Extreme everything, year 2000. There's probably more games in the stack that say extreme. Alright, so here's some more stuff that is kind of junk on Dreamcast. Hidden and Dangerous, PC port. Nothing special. Next is Monaco Grand Prix, one of the few F1 related games on the system. I don't know, kind of neat to have that, I guess. Next is one of the more interesting ones, I guess, that came out in the U.S. is Gundam Side Story 0079, Rise from the Ashes. It has about 5 subtitles. One thing I thought was cool when I picked this one up is when I took the disc out, it actually has some manga underneath the tray, which is kind of cool. Most of the Dreamcast games are, you know, pretty plain underneath the tray, so I thought that was kind of cool. This one did something a little different. Next is Centipede, new version of the old arcade game. Nothing special there. South Park Chef's Love Shack, crappy South Park trivia game by Acclaim. Next is Expendable, and this came out on PS1 as well, kind of a Contra-style game for the system. Then we have Test Drive 6. I don't know, I haven't played this one yet. Most of the Test Drive series was kind of watered down by this point. I will say Test Drive Le Mans for Dreamcast is really good. A few sports games are in the stack. So we have NCAA College Football 2K2, which I think was the only college football game that came out for Dreamcast. Vigilante 8, The Second Offense, so the sequel to the original on PS1. Another sports game, NFL Quarterback Club 2001. Then we have one that I think a lot of people love this game. I had this game when it first came out on Dreamcast, and I didn't like it. I actually sold this game back, but now it's one of the more desirable games to have for the system, so I have to own it now again, of course. I'm willing to give it another shot. Maybe I'll like it more this time, but that is Power Stone 2. Next is some more reported crap, and that is Army Men Sarge's Heroes. And then another sports game, NFL 2K1. And another game, Ultimate Fighting Championship, another sports game. Then we have WWF Royal Rumble, more stuff I don't care about. I have another of the RPGs on the system, of which there really aren't that many. This is one that, I don't know a whole lot about this one, but I think I would like to try this one, so I'll give this a chance, and that is Silver. Kind of a neat one-off game. There was no sequel to this or anything like that. Next is a game that I've heard a lot of good things about. This is one I just totally overlooked over time, but I don't know, maybe it's something I want to play, and that is Red Dog. I don't know. Like I said, it probably isn't really my style of game, but I have heard some good reviews of this game, so maybe I'm missing out on this one. Next is Draconis Cult of the Worm. Interesting title. I think it might be a PC port. I'm not positive on that one. Next is one of the soccer games for the system, and that is Striker Pro 2000. And then we have Ducati World Racing Challenge. So did the Suzuki game earlier, and this is the other motorcycle game for the system. So that is one stack of Dreamcast games. Let's do the other stack. Next we have F1 World Grand Prix. And some more stuff I don't care about. Matt Hoffman's Pro BMX. Next is a game that for some reason I just never had on Dreamcast, which is kind of weird because it's one of the more common ones, but that is Sonic Adventure. And this one's kind of cool because it's the two-disc version of the game that I think this was a pack-in in some of the later versions of the system, but it also has a trial of Sonic Adventure 2, which is kind of neat. Next one is Unreal Tournament. Don't care about that. This is one that I don't know why this came out on Dreamcast. This is just stupid. But the Who Wants to Be a Millionaire games were really popular around the time of the system, so they decided to make a parody game of those games as a trivia game, and it's Who Wants to Beat Up a Millionaire? Really? I don't know why somebody thought this was a good idea. PC port also, I believe. Then we have Namco Museum, and normally I'd be excited about getting a Namco Museum game, but this is just a crappy port of this, because the ones on PS1 had all the bonus extras. You got to see like all the memorabilia of these games. They were more faithful to the arcade display formats. These versions around this era, these were really rushed. I think the N64 version was just like this. I think American branch of Namco or somebody else put these together. Maybe it was Digital Eclipse, I can't remember. But these are nowhere near as good as the PS1 versions of these games. So get these on PS1 if you're not collecting for Dreamcast. Next is another game I don't care about, and that is Max Steel Covert Missions. This one is a game I probably should have owned before now. I think this is a cool game. I do like this series of games. That is Sega Rally 2 for the Dreamcast, which is a port of the arcade game. Next is one I don't really know a whole lot about, but I don't think it's anything special, and that is Incoming. And then we have, I think this is one of the last games that came out for the system. You don't see this one very often, but that is Worms World Party. And that was published by Titus, which they didn't really do a whole lot on Dreamcast. It's kind of unique. Next is one that also came out toward the tail end of the Dreamcast lifespan. This is when I think Sega of America was crying that they needed more games for kids, so they tasked Virtual Concepts, who made all the NFL and NBA sports games for the system, to make some kids' games for it. So the first one of these was Ooga Booga, which is a Mario Party style game. I don't think this one's very good. I don't know. I haven't played it yet, but I don't know. Kind of interesting story behind it, at least. Next, we have one that I think is kind of a Resident Evil style game that I haven't played, but that is Blue Stinger. And I think that was a launch game for the system. I'm not positive about that. Next is another survival horror game, and that is Carrier by Jalico. I think that was another early release. Next, I have a game that I've owned the import of this for several years. I don't really know why I bought it in import form, but there is a U.S. version of this. It is, I had to own this because I love Taito so much, but it's really not a great game. And that is Psychic Force 2012. And you can imagine what it was like when 2012 sounded so futuristic, and now it's a few years in the past. So, I don't know, it's a 3D fighting game. It's kind of free range. You can go anywhere within, like, a cube. It's kind of unique, I guess, for its time, but I think this game flopped pretty hard. Next, we have a game that's kind of a cult classic for the system, and I never owned this when it first came out. I do want to play this game. Not necessarily my first choice in style of game. It's survival horror, but I think this one kind of has some, like, funny B-movie style, grindhouse-style humor in it. So that definitely is my style of thing, and that is Illbleed. This is one of the games that's definitely very popular right now that probably flew under the radar big time whenever it first came out. I don't think gameplay-wise it's probably that strong, but as far as like the humor and style of the game, it's pretty unique. And I mean, this was the only way you could get this game on the Dreamcast, so it's kind of cool. Illbleed. Next is a good fighting game, and that is Capcom vs. SNK. I bought Capcom vs. SNK 2 on import Dreamcast. That one never came out in the U.S., when it was released, so that's why I never bought this one until now. But it's still a good game in the series. It's not as deep as the second one is, but still pretty cool. I did play this one a little bit this month. Like I said earlier, I never owned Sonic Adventure, and actually never owned the sequel either. I'm not really the biggest Sonic fan. Sonic's okay, but it just wasn't something I had to have all the Sonic games when they were released. So I did buy the sequel this month as well, which is Sonic Adventure 2. And I will say I do like the artwork on this one. I think it's very cool. Next is a port of, I think this one came out in the arcade, I know the earlier ones did, and that is San Francisco Rush 2049. 2049 still sounds a little bit futuristic, so I guess you just need to, like, aim the bar a little higher if you're going to collect games, you know, a few years after they came out, go beyond 2012 at least. Next one is a port of the PS1 classic, Resident Evil 3 Nemesis. One of the few PS1 ports that also came out on Dreamcast, so there was Dino Crisis and Resident Evil 2 as well. Next is another sports game, NFL 2K2. Then we have a game that, I don't know why this came out, it's kind of weird, Championship Surfer. Highly doubt that's anything good. Next is another sports game, NHL 2K. I think I picked up 2K2 last month, maybe. There is no 2K1, though, for NHL, which is kind of weird. Then I have MDK2, which, this game got good reviews when it came out. It's just, again, not really my style of game, so I probably won't be playing this too much. Next is another PC port, and that is Quake 3 Arena, which I think they actually did put a little effort into porting this to the Dreamcast. I remember this game was pretty well received when it came out. I think this had the full SegaNet compatibility, too, so you could play online with this, which is kind of neat at the time. Next one is a multi-disc game. This is a four-disc game, and that is D2. And there also was the original D on Sega Saturn, which I have not played, but it's kind of neat to have this one as well. Next is some more garbage, and that is Iron Aces. Whatever, Flight Sims, not my style of game. Next is one of my favorite games of all time. However, I don't think the Dreamcast is the way to buy this game. So that is Bust a Move 4. And we'll start with the artwork. It's really bad. Definitely U.S. designed. The other thing that really ticked me off about this game, most of the Acclaim-published Bust a Move games, they always have bad artwork. And this one is no exception. The other thing that bothered me about this game is that they released it under the Club Acclaim label. Bust a Move 4 may look cute and cuddly, it's actually a very difficult game once you get into more, some of the more advanced modes in it. So it was kind of a slap in the face to put it out on the Club Acclaim level label, because the reason they had that label was for games like Mary-Kate and Ashley games. So to put this in with that is not fair at all. I'm also going to do a little comparison and cover art of what you can do with this game, and I'm going to show you the PlayStation 1 version of this game that was put out by Natsume in the U.S. You tell me what you prefer, but this PS1 version of this looks so much better in my opinion. The other thing that bothered me about the Dreamcast version is it was a Windows CE port of the game, so it really doesn't even look as good as this PS1 version. So this is the one to get. Buster Move 4, I can't recommend it highly enough, just not on the Dreamcast. Buy this one. Okay? That's my rant on that. I've got two more games on the Dreamcast for this month, and then that's it. So next is Hoyle Casino, and this is another PC port of Garbage, I believe, for a casino-style game. The only thing I thought was interesting about this one is it has an ad on the inside of the cover here for a game that was never released. Probably was just another Garbage PC port, but that was a game called Sierra Sports Game Room. Just some shovelware with, like, darts and ping pong and, I don't know, pool and shuffleboard and air hockey and stuff like that. So, probably not a big loss that that didn't come out, but kind of cool that it has an ad for a game that was unreleased. And finally, for the month, I picked up one of my absolute favorite games of all time. I never owned the limited edition of it, so I had to have that too. I've been a big fan of this game ever since it came out. I just never owned the special version of it. So that is Shenmue, the original. And this has this little artwork on here that designates that it's the limited edition. The limited edition is really not all that special, because all it does is it adds a sixth disc. The game was already a five-disc game. And the sixth disc is just a music jukebox of songs from the game. So kind of neat, whatever. But I guess the cool thing about it is that you have these exclusive marks on the label and the back of the cover and the manual that say it's the limited edition. So this is pretty rare. I don't think a whole lot of these were released, so it's pretty cool to get. But that wraps up the game finds for this month. And like I said, I kind of went overboard this month. I bought a lot for all the systems as well, but especially Dreamcast. And as far as this coming month goes, I'm going to continue to focus on Dreamcast. I think I need about 80 or 90 more games and I'll have everything on that system. But the time seems right to collect for it. The stuff has not gone too crazy on pricing yet, and I think there's a lot of opportunity for future growth of the Dreamcast, because there are, I mean, a lot of the games in this stack are not that special, but keeping in mind, I have a lot of the really great games in the system already. So, yeah, that's kind of where I'm going with next month's collecting. I hope you guys enjoyed this video. Please like, comment, subscribe. Let me know how I'm doing. I'd love to share more with you in the future. Hopefully you enjoy my format. I try to just, you know, not just show you just the game. I try to tell you a little bit about it as well as going through everything I found this month. So I look forward to talking to you again soon. I will go over the games I picked up in July next month. And have a great day or night. Please subscribe if you have not already. And we'll see you next month. Thanks, you.